Gentlemen, I think we're live. Facebook gives us a little bit of a delay, but welcome to Find My Past Fridays Live. Once again, every week, we are here to help you out with your family history questions, mysteries, tell you a few stories and all kinds of things, and tell you most of all about the wonderful new records that are available through Find My Past, which we release every week. This week we have some wonderful collections, and it gave us a little bit of opportunity to talk about some new things. Do let me know, everyone, in the comments, if you can hear me and you can see me. That will make me feel a lot better that I'm not shouting into the void, because I always have to make sure this is all set up properly. But welcome. And let's talk about all the things we have. Seeing if there's anyone saying hello yet. Can't see anyone yet, which is a little worrying. To tell you about the wonderful collections that we're looking at. Occupations, jobs, all the things that your ancestors do. Where do we even begin? There are so many ways to find records of your ancestors' occupation, and so many ways to talk about what your ancestors did. First of all, trying to find what your ancestors did for a living is quite an interesting one. Begin with the simple things. Begin with occupations. Begin with... I've just realised I can't actually see the comments. I'm seeing that they're there. So now I know we're in. Right. Okay, I can see everything now. Oh, wonderful. Oh, that makes me feel much better. I see everything. I see Victoria, Hillary, William, Patricia. I'm no longer panicked. You might have told in my voice, hearing the silence was a little deafening, but that's great. Okay, I see everyone. Ah, oh, perfect. I feel so much better. That's great. Yes. Now we can talk properly, and I know that I'm not going to say something and then find you've all missed it. Occupations. Our ancestors all had them, now we have to find them. The first place to look is, of course, censuses, birth, marriage and death records, parish records. Your ancestors' core bits of history will often give you an occupation and will tell you more about what they did, and then we can use that to find many more records. And that leads us to our wonderful question of the week and to our new records as well. This week, we have a wonderful crop of records with some people that I definitely have to thank, as well as showing off these records and say that Farmer Past have done a great job at bringing them online. First of all, there's a huge collection of the people of Murray and Banffshire, which includes not only that set of the people, but also records of birth, marriage and death. And it's not just those people who are there at the time, it's people who originated there as well. So perhaps if your family moved a little bit, then it's still worth taking a look. And that's over 1,000 years of records there. So that's fantastic to see. Some of the older, earlier monarchs of early Scotland are in there too. Well worth looking a look at. But the most important, most exciting records that we have are, of course, records from the Burgesses and Guilds of Scotland. We've got our wonderful collection of Burgess and Guild Brethren, which covers the whole country, and it goes about 850 years worth of time. And that was the largest online, and we've just doubled the size of it. It's absolutely huge. It's fantastic. And that's come from two very large sources. First of all, big collection of earlier Burgesses and Guild Brethren from Edinburgh. That's a wonderful collection because that has all of the great and the good. Edinburgh being the capital of Scotland, you'll find Samuel Pepys, you'll find Ben Franklin, you'll find all manner of individuals in there. And very exciting to see a little bit of history play out. And then the most exciting part is records from the Trades House of Glasgow. And Glasgow Trades are fantastic. Glasgow was the workshop of the world for many, many years. And those records are fantastically held by the Trades House Library. And from 1846 to 1950, we've just added. And there are some wonderful little collections in there that are going to get you really excited, particularly all of the deacons, preces and other senior members of the trades houses have photographs alongside records. So that's a wonderful now searchable way to find perhaps a record of your ancestor and what they look like, which is great. I always love seeing someone's face when I look at records. But aside from that, there are so many people who joined the trades and joined the trades guilds and trades house, especially towards the modern day, as they became more of a charitable organization. But in the earlier years as well, when you're focused entirely on business, both of these are very important, and both of these have great chances for your ancestor to appear. And I can see lots of people saying questions already. I'm just going to go for their lovely answers to the questions here about the weather, and also people talking about some of their occupations that have come through. Karen, I'll get to your question soon. Hi, Jean. Nice to see you've made it. I really like Burgesses and Trade Guild records. This has been a little bit of a wonderful... Everyone has their favourite kind of record sets, and I, for one, love Burgesses and Guild Brethren. Burgesses aren't all town officials or people who've been made craftsmen in their profession. They can also be made Burgesses for doing great deeds, fascinating acts and wonderful things. And you can search these by keywords and you can find some really interesting things. So you can find, for example, I remember when we were looking through these, someone who managed to solve a murder from using a very specific kind of new autopsy, people who have saved children from a fire, people who have, in one case I remember in Edinburgh, just got the rest of the Burgesses exceptionally drunk and were given a ticket because of that as a benefit. However, that was taken away, which is still in there as well, because he was found later drunk himself, shouting abuse at those other members of the council later on in the streets. So it can go back and forth, but all of these notes are there and they are searchable by keyword as well. So take a look for things like fire and alcohol, a drunk, wine, things like that. You might find some other stuff as well. These were transcribed by many people, and these people I have to give a bit of a shout out to. We've got some wonderful volunteers who help to bring Findmypast records to life. If you want to join us, then send a message to Findmypast. But importantly, it's been keeping certainly me busy over lockdown and a few other people, and without their wonderful efforts, these records couldn't be made searchable in the way that they are. And then of course the Trades House themselves of Glasgow, who have been wonderfully curating and keeping these records safe for so long, and gave us the core to begin with, to start with. So it's a wonderful joint effort from our wonderful partners, and these records now online on Findmypast, giving a window into all of Scotland's occupational history for hundreds and hundreds of years. And as well as these records, which you should definitely look for if your ancestor had any kind of trade, and take a look. And then, as I said later, even if your ancestor just happened to be perhaps in Glasgow, they may well have joined the trades, because you didn't have to be, for example, a bonnet maker to be part of the Guild Bonnet Makers. So there are other people in there, and you will find out more details in their individual record. But when we look at occupational records, as I said, we find what they're doing, and then we start looking around for other information, other records that we can find, and there are huge collections. I notice a lot of people talking when they're answering this question that they have those two particular occupations that can strike a little bit of fear into people's hearts: agricultural labourer and miner. I don't know anyone who hasn't got one of those two in their family tree. I certainly have enough of each, and I'm sure you have too. But there are a few things to consider when we think about these people. First of all, when we talk about agricultural labourers, they often moved. When we look at a census, we are seeing a snapshot in time. We're seeing one particular time. It happens to be about spring. So that does bear into account, because these people might have moved for harvest or for planting, and they may not have lived in the area that they're in. And people often moved around within about a 20-mile radius, and they weren't always in that parish. I remember one of my favourite statistics is in the 1700s, about half of the people weren't buried in the parish that they were born in. And that's important to remember, because obviously we tend to think of people as being really concrete and rooted to where they live, and that's not as common as we might think. So agricultural labourers need to be looked at in all these surrounding farms, and then we can't take those assumptions that that's where they live, that they may be from elsewhere, and we need to look at other records as well. In terms of miners, There are many, many miners who have shifted from different kinds of metals, stones, all kinds of things. But when we can't find miners, they disappear. It's worth thinking about mining agents, particularly in the Victorian era, when the United States was becoming larger and more industrial, had such raw materials. And of course, then they needed people to get that material out of the ground. And who better than the people who had already been doing it for 30 or 40 years? So they brought these mining agents over who would offer locals a chance to have paid passage for them and their family and a guaranteed job when they got there if they only come and work for this particular company. And they would set up in different places and they would just encourage people from a particular town to go to work for a particular mine. This means often you get many people going all into one place. When we look at, say, Michigan, you might find a lot of people from somewhere in Lanarkshire going, or somewhere from Cornwall, because they're all going in the same way. And they're all being taken by the same mining agent and giving the same papers. My own ancestors also, some of them have travelled that way and gone that way because, again, probably some very persuasive agent, and that persuasion of money, of course, when perhaps another mine might not pay you as much is always exciting. And those people in America could pay well, especially compared to those in the UK quite often. There are also times when, for example, in Cornwall, which is I think the only county in the UK whose population is lower than it was in the Victorian era. And the thing with Cornwall is when the mines started to dry up, those people were in huge demand. The economy started to fall away and many people left. But those people were sought after in Australia, in America, in Canada, elsewhere. And there are many, many Cornish people who moved in that way. So when you have mining ancestors, take a look when they disappear. They may have emigrated and they may be as a result of this, particularly in the 1800s. And so it's another place to look and another thing to bear in mind. Outside of those two, I wouldn't say dreaded occupations, two all too common occupations that we all have to find a way around to find more about our ancestors. And they're no more special than anyone else's because you know, they've all had such hardships and such hard work. There is a wonderful mining museum. I think there's one in Scotland. I think there's one in the north of England as well, I remember, that can give you a bit more about what these lives were like. And they really did live very hard, very dangerous lives. I think I've shared my mining ancestor who was buried underground for many days at some point in the past. And yes, it was not too much money and lots of hard work. But when we look for other occupations and other things, then there are some great resources we can look for, and many of them are on Find My Past. The biggest first place, so once we have things like census details to tell us where our ancestors worked and what our ancestors were doing, are of course trade and postal directories. There's a huge collection for Scotland, Scotland Post Office directories. We've got a few separate for Dundee, and we have a collection of directories and almanacs which cover England and Wales. And these are, I would say, the first place to go, because when you, Sylvia said the mining museum is near Wakefield, I'm sure I remember that. I remember going, I think, but yes, it is a wonderful place. And Anya's saying you need to book when you go to see these museums, and there's one in Wales as well, which I didn't know about, so that's great. And so, yes, these trade and postal directories are fantastic for filling in the gaps between censuses and going before and after censuses. So we've got a huge collection online, especially on Find My Past, and these, search by name, search by address, whichever you like, but don't be afraid of browsing through them, looking through them the old-fashioned way, like if you have, say, the Yellow Pages today or something like that, a business record directory that you might get through the post today. Go through page by page looking, because they're alphabetical. Usually they're in two sections. You've got by address and you've got by name. They're indexed. And then look for your ancestor. And then hopefully you'll find them at the house. Maybe they're out in the census. You might find their occupation listed. Some occupations are listed in different ways. It's very important when we're searching to remember that. When we look for, say, miner, one of the big things that I try and do is I use asterisks, which are wild cards, because I'm not sure what may come before or after. You may find a coal miner. I put an asterisk before. They may list themselves as something else. They may say ironstone miner or something, and again, they may change. And then, of course, they may not call themselves miner at all. They may still call themselves a hewer or something like that. And there's different things like that. Coal face operative, I've seen. There are other things. So I use both the type of resource they're using. I use, say, coal or iron, and I use an asterisk. Or I also use the word mine, and I put an asterisk before and after so I can see if there's something else there as well when I'm looking for things like that. And that works with other occupations as well. And looking at trade directories can help to give you an idea of other ways that your ancestors may have described themselves if you're using that kind of information. And I see a lot of people saying that people worked in ironworks and smelting and this sort of thing. It's wonderful to see everyone seeing that they've got all these great hearty professions. And we're going to move now because I feel like I get too excited by miners and mining industry type things. So I've got to move away from them, or we'll spend all day talking about them. There's a great database on Findmypast, which is mining accident victims. I'm sure Ellie is in the comments and she's been passing a lot of those record sets across. There are some more for Scotland online, but they're not on Findmypast. But mining was very dangerous, as we know, and many of your ancestors may have been injured there or even killed. And so looking for their names there might give you some more information. But let's move to other professions. So we found maybe some more names in those trade directories and those postal directories, where we found a little bit more. We move maybe before the census afterwards. These records go up to the 1700s. But then how else can we tell the story? How can we find out more about what our ancestors did? There are lots and lots of smaller collections that can really help, as well as we said, trade directories, their guild records, burgesses. All of these things help when someone has a particular profession or occupation. Of course, professions are very, very specific when we think of professions. And so that's one thing to be aware of, the difference between occupation and profession, because you're not always looking at the same thing. But we have things like apprenticeships. Apprenticeships are very important. They start in about the 12th century, apprenticeships. Very, very long-standing and official thing. They lasted usually from being about 14 to 21. They're about 7 years. No one paid a wage for these. Usually the tuition was seen as the payment because it was setting you up for life. And they're often sometimes used to provide for the poor or the illegitimate. So maybe your ancestor was a child in a workhouse. They might find themselves being apprenticed afterwards to try and make good of them. And they go for there. See Marion with her fisherman ancestors. Wonderful. We've got some records for them coming soon. From 1563, nobody could practice a craft without first serving as an apprentice. And that's an interesting thing to remember. That means these special crafts that were used were kind of guarded away, and they needed these apprenticeships. However, there's a slight caveat in that the occupations that were listed that needed apprenticeships were all the ones that existed in 1563. So when the Industrial Revolution came along and we had all these new trades appearing involving machinery and involving, say, cotton weaving, they didn't count. They didn't need any apprenticeships. So it really unbalanced the market and changed things quite a lot, which is why this system started to change. 1709, I know Ellie has posted a list of country apprentices from 1710 to 1808, and they're important because the Stamp Act of 1709 put a tax on these apprenticeships, and that lasted until 1808. Through that, the apprenticeships became recorded, accounted, and they meant that we have this list of names of people from around Britain, which can maybe tell you if your ancestor is working, learning their trade to become whatever they are, whether they're a shoemaker, tailor, carpenter, bonnet maker, butcher, anything we can think of, merchant. The people that were exempt from this were people where the fee was less than 1 shilling, or those who had their apprenticeship arranged by, as we said, the parish or public charity, so those from the workhouse. Lots of apprentices weren't subject to the tax and they weren't recorded, so it's not complete. It's quite a large collection, but if records survive, you might find some from, said, these workhouses and things like that. The master paid the tax no more than a year after the end of the apprenticeship. It was sixpence, which is about 2.5 pence today's terms, on the pound for agreements of £50 or less, and 1 shilling for every pound after that. But Common trendy trades are harder to find. When we look at this, we have informal indentures, and they exist when a father teaches a son or an uncle or anything like that. I see Julie saying, is it correct that blacksmiths could perform a marriage? You're referring to irregular marriages, which are slightly different. It wasn't about being a blacksmith, so you didn't have to go and find a blacksmith. But irregular marriages are a very, very unique and interesting thing. I think there is a presentation we did a while ago about those different kinds of marriages and different things. It's a big detailed thing, and more so in Scotland. But yes, you don't have to be a blacksmith, so don't worry about that. Blacksmiths didn't have a second angle in conducting marriages, apart from Gretna Green, which is another story entirely. So a later act made the apprenticeship tax permanent, and it was abolished in 1804, but the payments carried on trickling in until the start of 1811. And these informal indentures were quite common. These things that we find in families when they're trying to make new occupations, new professions. I see Terry saying the Stamp Act, we know how that worked out in the colonies. That's right. Well, yes. In Britain, we've accepted quite a high amount of taxation over the years. If it moves, we've taxed it. And if it doesn't, sometimes we've taxed it as well. Window tax, hearth tax, poll tax, everything you can think of, rate books, all these things do leave paperwork. And so that means there are some great records that we can find and use for our family histories as well. Tithe maps, other collections too. I mentioned, as we said, these trade records, these guild records, and we're going to go back to them and explain why they're useful now. So it was all about these craftsmen of different trades. They banded together just to regulate their trades, to make sure that everyone was playing by the rules. Everyone was doing the same things, protecting the interests of those members. And that organization they formed was a guild. And those guilds had special privileges. They could vote, and they were called freemen. In a city, freeman was called a citizen, and in a town or rural area or a borough, they were called a burgess. And the city livery companies developed from these craft guilds from the 1200s and the 1100s all the way up to the 1500s. And the word livery originally referred to those uniforms they used to wear. Sometimes you'll find them. And there's, as Tracy was saying, the Gazette is a wonderful resource for occupations, particularly work. Maybe your ancestor may have done something involving their company. And we have just released last week a huge collection of the Gazettes from Edinburgh, London, Belfast, and Dublin. And of course, that's just the name of the capital of where they refer to. London for England and Wales, Edinburgh for Scotland, etc. They cover the whole countries they're respected, and they go up to the modern day. Definitely take a look at those too. They've been searchable in a new way. We're very excited by that, because you can search by name completely. Really, really exciting. So guild records are full of members, information on the journeymen that practice, advancements from the rank of apprentice to journeyman and from journeyman to master, contracts between the masters and the parents of apprentices can be included. And freeman records are often a lot more useful than apprenticeship records, because they give us lots of detail. These burgess records that we've just published, particularly, sometimes they have details of ages, birthplaces, parentage, occupations. And we have a huge collection of apprentices, not just from this national collection from the tax, but collections from all over the country. We have them from I wrote down a big list: Devon, York, Gloucester, Lincolnshire, London, Manchester, Dorset, Somerset, Edinburgh, many more as well as these records. If we see someone as an apprentice, they may well be in burgess records as well. So another thing to look for, a huge collection of records from London as well. And many people, of course, didn't reside in one of these places, but still had business interests there. So it's worth looking at these records too. Lots of guilds have indexed their own records as well. So we've got this huge collection. But if you know the trade, contact the guild. The Trades House Library, of course, in Glasgow, for these Glasgow records, may have more information about what your ancestors were doing, more information about their application, more information about them in particular. So it's worth taking a look. You'll find out more detail by contacting these trades if they still exist, or, of course, their trades house. Same for Edinburgh, same for other places as well, same for London. There are some wonderful libraries and organisations that can really help you. And of course, we have lots and lots of these records again that are scanned and in full colour, which will give you this detail that you can see firsthand. I love the early ones; they're great. I can see some, you know, that give you details of not only so name of person, their parent, their grandparent, they have different definitions. They have far hands and other things which will tell you about how related someone is when they join the guild, and you know, more about that. I see William Shaw said one of their relatives worked for Pilkington Glass and the company's still there. There are some wonderful old family-run companies, which is a great thing to see. And of course, it takes quite a while. There are a number still running and a number that we have records of. Newspapers, again, are a wonderful place. We always talk about newspapers. They are great. Those newspapers can tell you a lot about people's occupations and trades and business information too, just as they've always done. I see Maureen asking about apothecaries and surgeons. Did they have apprenticeships and where were they found? They had a more formal training. So we've got some great records of those people who are established members of the Royal Colleges of Surgeons and Physicians of Glasgow, Edinburgh, London, and people who have registered and recorded themselves as different things. So lots of different things of, you know, same with dentists, there are registers and we have those too. And other occupations have their own registers. Church of Scotland ministers is a wonderful thing, that fasty, ecclesiasty, wonderful thing that tongue ties everyone all the time. That is online on Findmypast, Church of Scotland ministers, with biographical information, records of the clergy, civil servants, of course, hemp and flax growers, merchant seamen. There are so many different niche smaller collections as well to look at. And then the other big collection I wanted to talk about and show you before we get really head first into the questions, because I know I've been unfortunately a little bit tied up with telling everyone all the different things and getting so excited to tell you about these wonderful records that I need to look more and answer some more questions myself. Trade unions, we have a huge collection of trade union records, but they again come with a few things to bear in mind. Trade unions began in the mid-1800s. Working conditions, as we mentioned when we talked about miners, were very, very difficult and very hard to deal with. And so trade unions thought, well, if we could collectively bargain, we could have a better deal and we might be able to have better working practices, better working conditions, and of course, better income. Trade unions were illegal until 1825 and the Combination Act, and they were barely legal until 1871. So before then, it's going to be very hard to find records of your ancestors in there. And you may know of things, people like the Chartists and things who are doing wonderful things for equality, for the working classes and things. And those have their own sort of individual ways you might be able to look at records. But our records run from 1871 to 1947. And from 1871, they become more and more common. And the start of the 20th century, they are huge. At that sort of point, usually, if you were in a trade, you're usually in a union. We have a number of different ones. We have railwaymen, we have lithographers, ironworkers, boilermakers. I can name a few more. I think we have carpenters and woodworkers and some more. But they give you lots of detail. I found my own great-grandmother working in the Union of Railwaymen. And because, of course, it's men and women, particularly as we get towards the Victorian era and the early 20th century. She was working as a ticket clerk at the Kilburnie Railway in Ayrshire. And I always wonder, as my great-grandfather came home from the war and probably came through that train station to get to his town, I wonder if that's where they met. So, you know, there's all these different things. And then you'll see there are lines through their records quite often, which means that they have stopped paying their dues. And sometimes it's because they've died and you'll find the date and things. But other times it may be they've married, they've moved away, or they've changed their occupation. So it can give us lots and lots of detail. Then, of course, we've got the Merchant Navy, wonderful collections there. That started in 1835, could register all the seafarers so that they could be used by the Royal Navy if they needed to, if there was some kind of war. The British Merchant Navy was one of the largest in the world. It was huge. Lots of them did fight in these wars as well. So if your ancestors were in the Merchant Navy during any times of conflict, look for them in naval records as well. And what I really love about Merchant Navy records is that they also, the later ones, have photographs. And those photographs are fantastic. Photographs of your individual ancestors are so exciting. So wonderful with these new records that were released this week with photographs. Also, we have many already looking at criminal records, looking at DC Thompson staff war album. So many different places to look. I could name all day. Another great place before I again start looking at all these different questions is the royal household. Almost 400,000 records are on Findmypast from the royal household. I noticed someone saying that it's a soul tie. What's that? Are you talking about my pin? Yes, I am definitely. There we go. I can see it's always backwards on the computer, so it's hard to tell. But I have my proud Scottish roots, and of course, I'm coming to you from Dundee, so definitely paying a little bit of tribute to that. And yes, Kilburnie is near Dalry in Ayrshire, which is where many of my ancestors come from. So yes, the royal household, almost 400,000 of these records, all the ancestors that work for the royal family. The collection is very, very extensive. It's not complete, but it does include some great names that you may know. Remember John Brown, the assistant of Queen Victoria. You remember some of the other more famous people that you may have remembered from all kinds of different movies and TV shows that have been on throughout the years, and some very interesting people. We have Thomas Farriner, the person who possibly started the Great Fire of London, accidentally, of course, working in the kitchens for King Charles II. We have the particularly interesting profession of the groom of the stool, which is a very interesting one, to do with being the king or queen's bathroom attendant, their toilet attendant, which was a very, very privileged and sought after position. So, you know, there's lots of interesting things we can find, and of course there are lots of great and the good in there, who are nobles and given positions as ladies in waiting and lords in waiting and things as well. So you might see some of your more illustrious ancestors. So I'm seeing some, seeing more questions. Victoria found a Freedom of the City of London paper for an ancestor, a needle maker. What does freedom paper mean, and how do you get given one? So these were given out by the City of London themselves. And the records that we have cover many of these. But if you go to the records of the City of London, I think the guilds and the trades, they will have more information. The Guild Hall will have you more papers, although I think we have many of those records scanned and online. So take a look at our records first. I see there are some wonderful records again. Ellie is sharing many, many wonderful records that we have. Teachers' registration records, 1914 to 1948, etc. There are so many of these individual records, and I don't want to spend all day talking at you. I want to talk with you. So rather than go through all of them, use our record A to Z, or A to Z if you're in America. It's the best place to find all of these records. If you want to find the new records from today, if you're opted into our newsletter, you'll get an email about it. But if not, you can type in guild, you can type in trade, you can type in your ancestor's occupation, you can type in a place, you can type in anything you can think of. You can't break it, and see what we have. And that is where you can find some of these wonderful, niche, exciting collections that might tell you more about your ancestors. I see Brian Cook's great-great-grandfather grew up in Kirriemuir, where everyone seemed to be weavers, then moved to Dundee to work the jute mills. Any chance of union or tradesman records for those? There were trade unions that dealt with the jute mills and things like that. There were lots of people who, of course, did exactly the same as the cotton weavers and everything. They did form unions. It's a little bit later. I don't know if we have those online. There will definitely be some records. I think there's an archive in Warwick, which I think they're called Trades Union Archive, they're where our records come from, and they have many more trade unions. It might be worth sending them an email and finding out some more. I'm seeing Andrew Davis. I'm related to a World War I flying ace whose uncle Andrew Benbow was superintendent in the Royal Mews 1913 to 1929. I have his complete history of payment. That is exciting. Hopefully you found our records of the Royal Air Force really useful to tell you a bit more about the flying ace. And then again, those newspapers, you'll probably find photographs. If he's a flying ace, he would have been used for all kinds of exciting ways to stir up the locals and to get people passionate about the war. So hopefully you'll find something, perhaps him stood by his plane or anything else. There's some great records too. William Shaw made a really good point about local archives. They have records, dockyard records at Portsmouth and Dunfermline are easily available and cover everywhere if the person went through either of a dockyard. Lots and lots of records of people's occupations are included in these kind of things. One of the places that I look for servants and things is a website called Scotland's Places, my Scottish people who served in various large houses, because they have tax records, and their taxes for male and female servants also included the names of the servants and the details of the servants. So perhaps you might find where your ancestor lived. And one little tip that I always give, which is a little bit lateral thinking, but it can be quite useful. When we find out your ancestor was a domestic servant or something, which I mean, I think everyone has a domestic servant ancestor, particularly before they're married in the Victorian era and before, you can then perhaps look for newspapers. If you know where they are, perhaps they're in someone else's house and they're outside of their own household. Maybe they took a while to find, so you know, good luck and congratulations if you've got them. But you know, when you find them, take a look at newspapers and look for the help wanted ads and look for the records of notes of people saying wanted cook or something like that. And you'll have the dates and you'll have, you know, the name of the address and things. And so look under the names of the people who are the head and family in the household that you're a domestic servant of. And you may find then an idea of when they began working as a domestic servant, which will give you a bit more of a span of their occupation, which can really help again to tell you when they lived where, to find them in other records. So that's one of my big secret little tips, and that's quite exciting. And yes, local archives are wonderful, they're fantastic. You can't recommend them enough. We have a huge collection of records online, and that grows every day. And it's thanks to, in many parts, lots of these local archives, libraries, individuals, but it's only scratching the surface. There's so much stuff that isn't yet online. So much stuff that you still have to do in the old-fashioned way. Unfortunately, right now, many archives, of course, are a little harder to get into and are perhaps operating on reduced staff and things like that. So we have to give them a little bit of leeway. But there are things we can do online while we wait. And there are catalogues online. Take a look at those online catalogues. Make notes of things you want to see as you go through, so that when things do open, you can see. Or if the archive is further away, perhaps you might want to hire a genealogist or someone who works at the archive to get those records for you and make copies, because that might be the extra missing link that helps you go further with records that are online or anything like that. So never forget archives. The Discovery Catalogue is quite good, which is the the catalogue of the National Archives in London and Kew, and that covers many other archives as well, smaller local archives too. And then again, think of your old friend Google and see what else is out there for your area and for your occupation. Family estates, there are, I think, if I remember rightly, about 350, I might have got that wrong, I may have even missed a zero, private archives in Scotland alone. And those private archives may be particular families, old families that might have records of their servants and things like that. And there are other ways to find these records. Some of them, again, have been deposited in local archives, but some of them still are with these original families. And it's up to them if they'll let you see them. You have to be very polite and very kind when you approach, because it's their choice. But many of them I find are very kind and very happy to help, and excited that you're interested in part of their family story too. So it can be quite exciting to see those wonderful things in the flesh, or to get them to give you copies. Seeing some more comments again. The bank archives on you say where their great grandfather worked on you found more information on when they started, when they retired, and bits about their income. Very, very useful. I know there's the Bank of Scotland archives in Edinburgh, I want to say. I remember contacting them a while ago. when we were looking at those wonderful Darien scheme investor notes that we published a while ago, records of those people who put all their money into that fateful attempt to build a colony on the other side of the world for Scotland. And if you don't know about that story, you really, really should take a look at, say, Wikipedia or anything to read that, because it's fascinating. Really, really interesting catalogue of errors that caused the Act of Union and the union between Scotland and England. And the people that put their money in and basically lost all their money, the little money that was to be repaid, they formed the Bank of Scotland to deal with it and to try and get the repayments. So the poor really didn't get any money back, and it started with the rich. But it's one way to find more information. You can find details of, again, your ancestors who worked, and perhaps sometimes your ancestors' accounts. If it's further and further away, obviously there are lots of privacy concerns when it comes to things like money. Yes, it's very, very important to find everywhere you can think of. If you have anything that you can think of that might have touched your ancestors' lives, find out how the occupation worked, find out what records may have been created along the way, and look at all of them. Helen said, if your ancestors became a merchant marine during the Civil War in America after immigrating from Ireland, is it possible they're in seamen or naval in Ireland? Where do you look for these records? It's possible. The difference with those who are in the merchant navies, there's a different degree of skill. So you can have people who just decide to join the Navy, and they can join with no practice or experience. And then you find people who have had their entire life in the Navy. And if they perhaps emigrate, they continue serving in the Navy because they know how to do it and they're very good at it. And so they can earn a decent wage. It's a difficult question. Definitely look, try and find these records. I'm not sure about Irish Merchant Navy records. I know the British ones that we have may include Irish people, so I would start with our Merchant Navy collection, but I'd be prepared to maybe look at the National Archives of Ireland as well, and maybe see if they have anything online, and of course definitely take a look at, again, researching in the United States as well, to see what their sort of naval records are like in terms of the military navy as well, because if they're in the merchant marine in that Civil War period, they may have been working militarily as well. Tess said, in regards to unions, my great grandfather Bill Stephen was a tool and die maker in Fraserburgh. He worked at the Chicago Pneumatic Toll Company, a US business based in Fraserburgh. He emigrated to Detroit in 1922 and worked in the auto factories there. I've been wondering if part of the reason he emigrated was the engineers' lockout of 1922. I'd love to find out if he was a member of a union in Scotland or in Detroit after he arrived. I've searched the records, but can't seem to find anything specific. Well, if you've searched our trade union records, that's a great start. If not in there, again, I think it's the University of Warwick that has these trade union collections, and they may have other records that aren't yet online. I would consult them and send them an email or a note, or take a look at their website and see what they have, and they might have something for them in Scotland. We've got here we go. So Tracy Barnett, I see William made a point. Would Ireland Navy records count as the Royal Navy, depending on the year? So records could be with the Ministry of Defence. It's a good point. The difficulty with Irish records is which ones still remain in London and which ones are still sort of administered by the British, and which ones have been handed back to Dublin. And so it takes a little bit of knowledge of each individual record set before you can sort of conclusively say where they are. For each record, I would always say, if it's a government thing, check in both places. Sometimes some related records are in one place, some are in the other, and it never hurts to just check twice just to make sure you might have missed something. So that's one of those big things. Sue Kelly said, can you access records for medical training in Edinburgh from the 1860s? There's a wonderful record set that's about ready to publish that I can't talk about just yet that might help you, Sue. So watch this space. We've got some wonderful more occupational records coming. A little known box on our website of Scotland Occupations and Professions, which is a relatively small set at the moment. It has, I think, all the photographers of Scotland and a few others. I think some candle makers and other things of the Highlands, and clockmakers and watchmakers, etc. We're going to add some more into there, and I think you might be pleasantly surprised when it comes to any physicians or surgeons in Scotland. But of course, again, when we look at physicians and surgeons, and again, these trade directories and the trade guilds and trade organizations. Many doctors registered with more. They may have registered in perhaps Edinburgh, and they may have then served in India or England or anywhere that they were transferred or they chose to go. It's worth looking for their records in London as well and other places. But look out for some new records too. I'm seeing Marion saying, my great-grandfather was a galvanizer's laborer when he came up to Scotland. I wonder if that could have been in the shipyard. It's possible. That was in 1914. Glasgow was a huge draw for these kinds of trades. Glasgow, as we said, we mentioned it was the workshop of the world. It was a very, very industrial city. It grew rapidly because of the Industrial Revolution and because of all of the trade coming through into the docks and ports of Glasgow. The shipbuilding trade there was huge. So was a lot of the feeding trades and feeding businesses that went through that. And so it was a city that really was on the up and became just absolutely world known. Many things made in Glasgow appear in New York, appear in Chicago, everywhere you can think of. It's a massive place to look at. That's one reason why these trades records for Glasgow are really, really important, because of so many people that may be in there, may be included, particularly, of course, a lot of people who became wealthier due to the money that was coming into Glasgow. So it made a lot of people's lives better as well as providing more occupations. The same for Manchester as well in England. These industrial cities grew quite quickly, and a lot of cities around the north, when we have the mills and things, Sheffield, Leeds, etc., that were very, very small until these things happened. But the ships and the shipping industry were huge, and they were really, really important. If your ancestor was in that area, then it's quite possible. You need to look at company records to find out more, and some of them are spread around. I know the University of Strathclyde has quite a large collection of Glasgow employment records. I remember looking at those some years ago. So again, look around and look for, if you can find the company, if you can find details of where your ancestor worked in particular, which may be on a census, it may be on a trade directory, but it will tell you then where to look for these extra records. One of the great exciting things that makes the 1921 census for England and Wales so fun is the fact that it gives you where your ancestor worked in detail. It tells you who they worked for or what their company was called. So that's going to be something really useful for finding more details about your occupation. I know we see one name studies and one place studies. I wonder if we'll start to see things like one company studies and things. So that could be very exciting, and it would be great for any kind of company research that might come in. So that's something that I can't wait for, although we've got a little bit longer to wait too. I see Tracy Barnett saying, a maternal grandmother was a domestic servant in a household in Poole, Dorset in the 1901 census, moved with their daughters to Bristol in 1911 census, then went to my widow grandfather as a housekeeper in 1918 before they married in 1920. Yes, the amount of movement that domestic servants and people who worked in other houses can do is astounding. So when you're looking for someone who perhaps is under maybe 22 or so in a census and you can't find them in a household, don't just look in the same town. Look for a considerable distance and look for anyone with that name. And look, using one of the exciting things that I do when I use that, again, that record A to Z, and look for a specific census. Look using birthplace, maybe a county, because that place might not be so familiar to whoever enumerates. So they might have got the county right, but the place might be slightly wrong. They may, for convenience, the domestic servant might have named a slightly larger place nearby because they'd have no idea if the small village might even be known. So they just probably didn't bother and say, well, I'm from Manchester, rather than saying I'm from Godley or somewhere nearby, a very small village in the area. Take a look at that. Look for someone born in that county, but not living in that county. Just living anywhere in the country with that name and with your birth years, and you might find two or three, and then you might find your domestic servant relative. I see lots of different people talking about wonderful things about their ancestors. It's great to see us all come together like this. Tracy Barnett said, my ship Chandler ancestor was born in Danzig, Germany, which is now Donsk, in Poland, 1838. Married an Irish lady in Swansea in 1865. A business in Bristol. Your family have moved everywhere, Tracy. That's going to be one of those things that's going to be a little hard to move around. Anya said, it's very interesting to hear about the potential new museum they want to open in Greenock to do with the slave trade. That's important, and that's something that will be quite interesting. We have a lot of records of those people who worked and were working on, let's say, cotton or sugar or anything like that. But then we forget sometimes the other side of things, those people who were very terribly treated on the other side of things in the New World and in the colonies as slaves to obtain this raw material that was then worked up. So it's important to recognize every part of this, because it's all part of not only our ancestors' story, but you know, the story of the world and of history and how everything became how it is. And we should never forget any lesson, as we probably know more than anyone as genealogists, that you know, the situations our ancestors find them in could easily happen to anyone. And so any hardship that anyone suffers is a terrible thing that we should all remember and try and make sure it never happens again. So I'm very keen on seeing all of these kinds of museums and ways to teach people a lot more about those kind of the darker parts of history, so that we can you know, make sure we don't relive them and learn from them. Patricia said their aunt did all domestic work, but their mother was sent to the priest house and didn't let long last long because she said she was not going to be a skivvy for anyone. That's a good one. I see a few people talking again about say Glasgow, Manchester, things. They are the big cities. Well, depending when you're looking for your ancestors, again, it's the industrial world that we're mostly kind of stuck on, I think. If you're lucky to get further, then things become a little more I want to say sedate, and people don't move around as much and things. But when these big cities started to grow, people came from far and wide to start setting up and to start hopefully a new life with more money coming in, steady work, etc. And so although the conditions might have been terrible, it was one of those things that might have again started your family story in a new place. So when your ancestors can disappear, take a look in these bigger cities nearby as urbanization ran through. Pat said there's an international slavery museum in Liverpool. I haven't been to that, but that sounds like a really good one, so that's worth looking at as well. I know they're building one in Charleston, I think, as well, over in the United States, and that would be an interesting one too. I have actually done a fair bit of research on very early slavery in Scotland for some of my own family history research, and that's a story for another day again. But yeah, so this is again something that I'm particularly interested in and particularly keen that you know, we don't forget some of these hardships that people have lived through, even if it's not our own family. If our family perhaps have been involved or part of this, then again, we should make sure that we understand all parts, the good and the bad, when it looks at family history. Jamie said their great-grandfather William Robert Duncan was a stevedore on the Govan docks. He died loading a ship in 1903 when their grandmother was 5 months old. Jamie, I hope you've looked. You've probably got the death certificate, death record. You'll probably have some kind of coroner's record for that, and so that'll be worth looking at as well. Usually they're in the for Scotland, the RCE, which is attached on Scotland's people, so you can take a look there, and then a register of corrected entries that RCE stands for. Then also newspapers, because that sounds like something that would have been commented on and would have been recorded. So take a look at those newspapers and you might find some more detail. And see lots of people talking about different things here. See lots of people saying that do corporations still exist, like the Rye Corporation pre-1850? I haven't done very much research in Sussex, so I don't actually have an answer for you about that specific corporation. But the first place I would look would be Sussex Archives, and I would take a look there, because they may have records deposited, or at least will have more knowledge of the local area and be able to tell you. These are you know, very specific smaller collections that help us to tell that story, but because they're so specific, sometimes it takes that local knowledge to push you over the edge and tell you exactly where these things are. And sometimes they're in a box that only a local archivist knows about, and they get very, very excited quite often when they have that record that can be the key to unlock your family history. So it's really worth getting in touch. I found lots of those things. Some are in the National Archives in bigger collections, some again said these local wonderful archives. Lots and lots of more. So we have trying to get through as many questions as we can in our last 5 minutes, and more sort of comments and things. It's wonderful to see you all saying hello and everything else. I'm definitely very, very excited that you've all been able to join us on this day with some great records to look through and to talk about some of the other records that we have that you might not have used, which is always of interest and always very, very exciting. There are so many different ways we can add to our family story, and so many different ways that we can look at records, interrogate them, use that record A to Z, search from the main search, build a family tree and watch those hints that pop up, and all of them are hugely, hugely useful. Every single record is great, but every single record has perhaps maybe 9 or 10 or maybe 11 or 20, 100 perhaps, different little touch points that might tell us more and tell us where to go next. So even if we haven't got any records in front of us, we can't find records, go back to the ones you have and inspect them entirely. Look through in detail to find things, like I said, the kind of occupation your ancestor had, anything that say might say where they worked, anything that might give you a clue that might lead you towards where they may have married, because they're in a particular place, because that's where someone's profession, their occupation was, and maybe it was closer to work and they could do so. There's so many different things that we can learn, and we can put things in context, and we could understand more if we take everything. Even when we look at an ancestor's marriage and we look at perhaps whether they sign with an X or whether they sign their name, it might give us a clue to their education or how much money they might have had, if someone was married by bands or by license. All these little clues really, really help. And all of these records, whether they're occupational or otherwise, on Findmypast and elsewhere, are like breadcrumbs that lead you to that pot of gold at the end. And they're all really, really important. So inspect everything. And if you have no more records to inspect, and if you have no more records to find, for now, of course, because there are new records every week, then start looking at the context of how your ancestors lived. We've mentioned some really, really useful museums and places to look, which are great to tell more of our ancestors' story and how they will have lived, etc. But also look about the occupation itself. Look, read books, find out what life was like for those people. And it might, again, give you more of an understanding. It might help you to think like your ancestors, so you might find more records or at least understand more about why some things that don't quite fit might fit. Or it might tell you that some of the things that you found don't fit because of something that might happen too. I see Linda's definitely not with us next Friday because they're going for a hip replacement. So best of luck, Linda. Fingers crossed. Hopefully we'll have you back here hunting for ancestors soon, and see everyone else. Amanda's saying they're going to go back to old records. Oh, they have, and they found vital clues they missed years ago, pushed many lines back to 1600s. You're very right, Amanda. Witnesses to documents are key, very, very important. They are friends of the family, often relatives. Sometimes you'll find, in one case I remember, of two brothers marrying two sisters. The brother and sister married, and then the brother and sister were witnesses for the same marriage, and then they flipped around for the other marriage, which was a couple of years later. And of course, those people weren't married when the time was, they were witnesses, and you wonder, well, obviously maybe they maybe met there, or they knew each other beforehand, or anything like that. But it, again, tells you more, and it might help you to know you've got the right sort of people there. I see lots of people saying, you know, hello and goodbye. Marion saying her cousin lives in Delta. Claire, Jerry Brown has said, what was a glover? A glover, of course, was someone who made gloves. So that's, you know, one of those professions that, especially in the chill of going out to work or anything like that, or if you're maybe working with something that needed your hands to be protected, gloves very, very important. Anya is saying that they found some bits about family involved in illegal combinations in East Lothian. They were coal miners, and they need to go and find the records themselves when things are reopened. Very, very true. Jan has said they found five spellings for one of their ancestors called Muir. That's one of those ones, isn't it? There are lots and lots of different spellings, and as spellings became more solid as we get later on, it becomes easier to find their ancestors. But be unafraid of using wild cards, asterisks, question marks. We've talked about these, and I talk about them pretty much every session that I do, and I think it's really important to keep talking about them, because they can find some records that you can't get hold of. An asterisk is you don't know what's in front or what's there, or even nothing is there. And a question mark means you know which letter's there. You know there's a letter, but you don't know what the letter is. So use those to find things like muir, any names that begin with a, you know, might have an E that disappears or anything like that, lots of things. I've seen one more question from Jan. What is a cutler? They made cutlery. So there you see, that's where these words can come from. The roots will go through. Marion said they've got a granny who had two brothers and a sister who married two sisters and a brother. It's more common than you think when families get close. Janet has said, I'm going to make this the last question that I'm going to answer live. But of course, as I say always, you've all taken the time to ask questions. So I'm going to go back and I'm going to try and answer as many as I can afterwards as well. So don't feel afraid and feel like you've lost out. You all, you know, deserve a little bit of attention because you've taken some time out of your day to sit and watch with us. It's really important. Janet, why would some marriages have bans and some didn't? So bans were the calling aloud of someone saying, you know, does anyone have any reason why these people can't marry? If so, things are stopped and they'd call them aloud for 3 weeks for a marriage. A license is when obviously the rich would never lie, so someone who's rich could just say, trust me, it's okay, there's no problem, and they pay for this license, and then that license means that you avoid the whole ban system. So if you could marry by license, it meant you had a little bit more money. It was outside of the realm of perhaps some of the more working class occupations. And it might give you a bit more of an idea. The license was handed to the priest, and usually it was destroyed. It wasn't really kept, so there aren't many records of those. Other than we see on the wedding itself, we see that the marriage was by license, and we see, you know, there are handfuls of licenses that survive, and you could find a surviving license. It might not be your ancestors, but if you want to look at an example, there are some online. But bans are quite interesting, and there are more of those that survive, and those bans are useful because sometimes a wedding never happened, so you might have some bans and then no wedding, which is interesting. And then, of course, they will give you some more dates for people preparing for a wedding. And so it's a wonderful extra resource, too. We've got lots of those online on Findmypast, too. So we've hit the end of our hour, the top of the hour. And so I want to say thank you very much, everyone, for being here. It's amazing to think that we're all sat at home all over the world, all sharing this great love of genealogy and of our own ancestors, and paying tribute to them in all the different ways that we do, and building our family tree. And it just makes me fantastically honored to be helpful in this, if I am. And if not, then at least to curate all of you coming together as well to enjoy this hour. So thanks for coming. Thanks for listening. I hope you enjoy the new record collections, and there's new records every week. So if you don't find your ancestors in these, don't worry, there's more to come. Keep subscribed to the newsletter and keep going. Keep using our wonderful records. Keep talking on the Findmypast forum, and keep hanging out with us. We'll see you again next week. I believe that next Friday you will have Alex Cox again, telling you more wonderful, wonderful stories. I won't do the accent, but he is, it's Ellie. So I definitely won't do that accent either. But Ellie will be entertaining you all kinds of wonderful things. I think we have some great records coming up. I remember them being prepared. So some that I think some of you have been asking for a while. And then a week after that, I think we've got something even more special. So keep your eyes peeled. And for those in the know, I will say no, I won't actually. I'll keep that secret. But thanks very much. I was about to try some very, very awful Welsh, which I'm trying my best to learn Welsh. With my own Welsh roots that I've recently discovered and things, but I'm not good enough, I think, yet. So ask me again in a couple of weeks and maybe I'll be able to do it again. But enough about that. Thanks very much, and hopefully I will see you again soon. You're in good hands with everyone else, and keep on sharing your family history stories with everyone else. I hope to see you again. Take care, and I'll see you later. Have a great weekend, everyone.